questions over the stuff that we went over right prior to spring break. To summarize, what we did is we went over a number of different ways to take and to lay out your page via CSS. We used floating, was the last way that we went over. We also used fixed position, relative position, and a few other techniques. Those are all techniques to lay out your page. They all have their place. Part of the job of being a designer is to understand the appropriate time to use appropriate methods. All right. If there was just one method that was like the best way to do it, then I wouldn't waste my time talking about the other methods just to say, okay, we're going to study this, but we're never going to use them. All right. It doesn't make sense. They all have their place. And the more fixed layouts, the ones that use pixels and absolute positioning, are typically used when you have a very specific layout that you want to achieve. And you don't want the flexibility of stuff moving around on your page. All right, some of the pages that we looked at on the CSS ZenGuard were like that. They had a very specific layout where things had to be in the right space. All right. Now that may be good for a desktop, but it might not be good for a mobile device. All right, so what do you do? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about things that you can do to sort of optimize your web pages for both a desktop and a mobile device. And I shouldn't have to tell you that that's an important consideration. All right, with the widespread use of mobile devices for going on the web. You might say, but someone might say, why do we need to worry about making our mobile site, our websites mobile compatible? Won't people just download the app if we have an app? So for example, you know, let's pick something, Amazon, let's say, you know. Amazon has a mobile app, and they also have their website optimized for a mobile device. Why would they do both? Why have both? Why not just do one?
I'm sure they can do
both. Yeah, exactly. But it's the flexibility. Different people have different preferences. You know, there may be something that I don't visit regularly, but I want to visit from time to time. For example, for a while when my phone was limited on space, I wouldn't download the Facebook app. I'd simply use the web browser to navigate through Facebook, all right, because it didn't take up all the space with the app. There might be something I don't use very frequently, like, for example, a weather application. You know, weather.com has an app, but they also have their website, and it should be optimized to work well for mobile devices. So it's just a matter of covering all bases and being flexible. One good thing, a positive of a web page, is that all you need is a web browser to view it, which means even on a very low-end phone, not even a smartphone, all right, but any phone that has a web browser can view a mobile web page, all right, whereas you need certain phones to run apps, all right. So that's one big advantage of a mobile web over an app. Apps, you have to develop apps for each platform, typically. You have to develop a Mac version of the app and an Android version. Now, there's things you can do to make that easier, but still, you can't download a Mac app on an Android phone or vice versa. It has to be native to that. One advantage of apps is that it can take advantage of the native mobile hardware better. It's easier to integrate with, say, a camera or a Facebook app or the gyroscope, the accelerometer that's in it that tells whether you're level or not. All those things are easier to do with an app than with a web page. All right. So there's advantages and disadvantages of both. The big advantage of a mobile-enabled web page is that you're leveraging some resource that you already have. You already have a website. So might as well go the extra mile and make that website work well on a mobile device. All right. It may not be as specific as an app. It might be a little clunkier. In other words, you have to open up your browser and then navigate to it. All right, as opposed to having a nice little desktop icon or screen top icon that you can press and do it. But again, it has the benefit of people don't have to go through the trouble of downloading it, upgrading it, and so on. If they have a web browser, they can access your website. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about ways that you can make your website optimal for a mobile environment. And we're just going to cover some of the ways. We're not going to cover all of the ways, because all of the ways require technology that we don't really cover extensively in this class. When you start getting into some of the more advanced techniques, things like server-side scripting and client-side scripting come into play. And we don't cover that in this class. So I'll introduce those things, but I will not really dwell on them. I'll dwell on the things that we can do with the stuff that we do in this class. So there's a fair amount of them, so it's not like you're going to get cheated, all right, by not covering that stuff. First of all, I'd like to ask you, what is different about accessing a mobile device via your phone versus accessing it via a computer?
Processing power.
Number one, processing power.
Header is going to take up all the space on the board. I'm not going to have any room to write stuff underneath that. Computer's more powerful. All right. What's another difference?
Real estate on the screen.
Yeah, the screen size. I'll tell you what, I'm going to flip these because we're talking about mobile stuff, not desktop sites. So mobile has less power, processing power. Mobile equals less screen space. To the internet speed, which one probably typically will have a faster connection to the internet?
Wired.
Pardon me?
Wired connection.
A wired connection. So a computer that you would have wired to your internet provider. So a mobile may have a slower connection. So when I'm at home, and my phone is connected to my wireless network, and it has as fast a connection as my laptop does. So under those circumstances, it's even. A mobile device, however, if I'm out and about and not connected to a wireless network and I'm just on the 4G, then I have slower speed. And if I have a wired connection at home, then it's going to be a slower speed as well. So one thing I can say for sure is a mobile device isn't going to have a faster connection than a computer. So depending on the circumstances, it might be slower. The best you can hope for is it being the same. What's another difference? And I'll tell you what, this difference has less to do with the actual hardware than the mindset that people come to a mobile website versus a desktop website. If you know you're going to spend a lot of time researching something, if you're researching for a term paper, let's say, you have to write a research paper for your psychology class, and so you're going to be online and you're going to be researching, and you might be downloading articles, and you might be quoting articles and taking notes and doing stuff like that. Which would you be more likely to use, your mobile device or your desktop device?
Desktop.
Desktop device, I would say most of the time. When would you be more likely to use your mobile device?
Casual reading.
Casual reading?
Yeah, fairly quick facts.
Quick facts? When you're out and about, right? When I'm in my car, not while I'm driving, of course, but when I'm stopped in a parking lot, all right, and I want to look up what time a movie is, or what is someone's phone number, my insurance agent, or any number of different things, I'm liable to do it. So mobile device, as the name implies, you're taking with you, and it's with you all the time. So mobile devices, to sort of summarize this, I will say that the user's goals are more focused. I think that's a good way to say it. In other words, if I am going on a website and I just want to sort of explore, and I might want to read an article and think about it and follow a link and go it, you know, well, I'm probably more likely to do that on my laptop or a desktop device. Whereas if I am just want something when I'm out and about and I want a very specific fact, very focused sort of question that I have an answer for, I'm more likely to do that on my mobile device, you know, because I'm out and about. What are other ways that the user, that there are differences, besides the smaller screen means that there's less space for stuff. A mobile device also has a different way. Of interacting with the web page. For example, you actually physically touch the links as opposed to navigating a mouse over and clicking it. And in some respects, that's cool, except when it isn't cool. When isn't it cool?
Scroll bars.
If there's scroll bars, that would be one example. Or another example where just being able to touch on a link isn't necessarily good. When it's so small, or if they're closely, if they're not, there's not adequate space in between them. You know, with my finger, I'm able to press and get, like, the link next to something if I'm not really careful. All right? In addition, you don't have a full keyboard, so you're pecking away. And some people get very fast at doing that, use the two thumbs. I still use the index finger. Whereas when I type, I can actually use both index fingers, so that gives me an advantage of typing versus on a screen. So something that you would spend a lot of time typing, you're apt to be more to use more often on a desktop machine than on a mobile device. All right. So all these things, everything about the hardware of a mobile device, everything about the mindset of the user accessing something on a website on a mobile versus a desktop, the way that you interact with a mobile versus a desktop, all these things point to, as a general rule, a mobile device, a mobile version of a web page will typically be simpler than a desktop version. Okay. Now if we throw in, remember mobile device is still a pretty broad topic. I've been mainly thinking about phones when I've been talking about mobile devices, but also fall into the category of a mobile device, right? And tablets are like phones, but, you know, they have pretty big screens and so on. So, you know, you could almost consider a tablet functionally as sort of like halfway between a phone and a desktop. The phone is going to be more, the phone's going to be less powerful, small screen. Tablet probably will have a bigger screen than a phone, but not so big as a desktop machine, and so on and so forth. So typically, we want this to be simpler than a desktop version. So, what does that mean? Well, we might want to get rid of clutter on our website for the mobile version. All right, we might want to make the design simpler. We might want one column instead of three columns, for example. All right, we might want it so that a page displays as one column instead of three columns, a more elaborate layout. We might want to get rid of some content. Maybe there's some content that isn't absolutely essential. For example, if you compare mobile versions of a site with a desktop version, typically there's going to be less content on it. You know, on a news site, for example, CNN, there's going to be a whole bunch of stories, whereas there may only be top headlines on the homepage of CNN's mobile version, all right, because they know that you're probably not going to spend time studying it, that you just want the quick information. All right? So, in general, we want simpler in mobile and more complicated in desktop. Now, that's really the challenge. That adds complexity to developing a website, right? Because we talked about user goals and all those things, and we talked about coming up with the design. Now we have to design for two sort of circumstances. One of them is where someone's accessing it via desktop versus via a mobile device. So we have to design for that, right? Or we ought to design for that. So, really, if I wanted to make the assignment more challenging for the project, I'd ask you to define different goals for a mobile user as for a desktop user, because there likely could be different goals for one group of people than the other. All right, so we want essentially a web page to look two different ways, or we want the potential to have two different ways. What we don't want to do necessarily is get rid of everything on our site and make our desktop version as simple as a mobile version, right? That wouldn't be a good idea too, just because there's some limitations in a mobile version of the site doesn't mean that we want to eliminate good content from the desktop version of the site. All right, that's, you know, we don't want to, quote, dumb down our web page by getting rid of some stuff that's good but maybe not essential to the mobile user. So we might want two different versions of our site. Or, put differently, we might want our site to look a little bit different between a desktop version and a mobile version, with the mobile version typically being simpler and the desktop version being more complicated. All right? So less of everything on the mobile version, more of everything on the desktop version. Now, how can we do that? There's a couple approaches that we can do that. All right. Depending on the kind of website that you have, you might want to take one approach versus the other. One thing that I want to really make sure that you understand, and I want to try to emphasize this every time I talk about design things, is that design is an art. There's no like one size fits all solution for a website. Like, this is the way to do it. Right? That's why there's options. Like I said before, if there was only one good option, then it really wouldn't be an option. Everyone would just always do it this way. But depending on the kind of site it is, you may take a couple different approaches to get a website that's workable on a desktop device and a website that is workable on a mobile device. For some sites, and this would probably be more true for smaller sites, less complicated sites. Again, the one that I always come back to is a restaurant, right? You go to a restaurant, a typical restaurant, unless it's a giant chain, you know, we'll have like maybe 4 or 5 pages, you know, here's our menu, here's our hours, here's how you contact us, here's how you make reservations. You might be able to have one site that works for everyone. In other words, we have one set of HTML one set of CSS. Some of the designs that we did last week, if we were to look at them on a mobile device and on a desktop, they would look reasonably good. And with a little bit of work, they might be workable in both the desktop device and or a desktop computer and a mobile device. Again, this is typically true for smaller websites. All right. Another option would be to have one set of content that's styled differently. All right. Now, what that means essentially is there's one set of HTML and multiple CSS. Now we've already seen examples. We've done examples in class, and your assignments included examples of this, and we saw in CSS Zen Garden that if you design your web page correctly, it's easy to take one web page and apply a different style sheet to it. Take and apply style sheet 1, it looks one way. Take it and apply style sheet 2, and it looks a different way. We've all seen how to do that. All right? The one thing that we haven't covered yet that we're going to cover today is how it's possible to have on one page two different style sheets. And you build into the style sheet's instructions to say, well, use this style sheet for everyone, and use this style sheet just for a mobile device. So we can specify in our code when to use a certain style sheet. So we could have a style sheet that applied to everyone. Or we could have a style sheet that applied only to mobile devices. Or we could have a style sheet that applied only to desktop devices. So, that certainly is a lot better than rewriting the entire site and having two versions of the site, right? Because you still only have one version of the HTML, you're just applying different style sheets to it. By applying different style sheets to it, you can give a different look. And one of those looks will be a simpler look for the mobile version, and one of them will be a more involved, more complicated version of the site. I should say a more thorough or more detailed version of the site for a desktop. Anyone predict what the third option is going to be? So we started with one of everything. Now we have one set of HTML, one set of CSS, or two sets, or multiple sets of CSS. What do you think the third one's going to be?
Two sets of
HTML. Exactly. We're going to have different HTML and different CSS. So essentially, we're going to have two separate versions of the website. Two total separate versions of the website. And so there'll be multiple. And I've been saying two, but it's probably better to say multiple, because you could actually do this where you had not just a mobile and a desktop version. You could have a flip phone version, a smartphone version, a tablet version, and a desktop version. All right. So anytime I say multiple, I've been using the example of desktop and mobile, but really you could get various degrees in between of
real simple mobile, smartphone, tablet, and so on. Multiple HTML and multiple CSS. Now, if you're smart, when you're doing this, if you're taking this option, you will be clever and figure out ways to reuse pieces of one site on another, on the other version of the site. You'll more than likely use server-side code, server-side scripting, which we do not talk about in this class. But we would more than likely use PHP, ASP.NET, something along those lines to accomplish this. So it wouldn't be quite as bad as building the entire website twice. It would be extra work, but it wouldn't be quite as bad because we'd be able to reuse some of the work for our mobile site, for our desktop site, and vice versa. The further down you go, the more work it gets, right? The further down you go, the more detailed the site is likely to be. When would you take an option like this? You would take an option like this if you had a very large website and you know that people aren't going to access the entire website on their mobile device and you just want to give them the most important things, but you have a whole lot of stuff. All right? So the bigger, more detailed the site is, the more likely you're to take this approach because you're liable to overwhelm people if you put all that detail on a mobile device. Yes?
Like a newspaper website?
A newspaper would be a great example of that. Because again, if you go to a home page of any news site, there's going to be a whole bunch of news stories. Whereas on a mobile version, maybe they just show the five most important stories. And maybe they have a link to go to other places or something along those lines. So, this is less work. This is the most work. This is appropriate for smaller sites. This becomes more appropriate for larger sites. Now, we're going to talk about these two in this class. All right? We're not going to talk about this one. All right? That one, if you want to find out, see, I don't know, I don't think I'd do it for this purpose, but you know, like Hollywood, whenever they have a movie, like they never like kill the villain off completely, right? The villain always somehow escapes and shakes his fist and say, "I'll get you next time, Spider-Man," you know, or something like that. Why? So they can have a sequel, right? Well, one of the sequels to this class is CISS 268, which is mobile web development, where we focus on some more of these details. So that'll be the cliffhanger from this section of the class. And hopefully that'll make you curious enough to want to enroll in CISS 268, where we cover stuff like this, but we cover it in way, 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 way more detail. All right? Okay. So we're going to talk about one and two. We're not going to talk about three. So, we've already learned a good deal about one and two, believe it or not. All right? There's really just one piece that we need to learn. All right? So, we talked about different ways of doing CSS, all right? We talked about using CSS where sizes of things were in absolute pixels or sizes of things were in percentages. What do you think would be better for developing one CSS file that works both for a mobile device and a desktop device, where we use percentages or where we use absolute number of pixels?
Percentages,
all right? So first thing we're going to do is we are going to use percentages sizes. So like the width, the height, largely the width. We might use pixels for margins, padding, border, and we might use a minimum width in pixels. When we talk about laying something out on the page, the width to get the maximum compatibility between mobile and desktop, we're going to give things widths that are percentages. All right? We're going to float stuff a lot of times. We're going to float or use the flow method. Remember, what is the flow method? The flow method is where you don't put any positioning on your HTML document, and things just sort of align in the natural way that they would align. All right? Or we might float stuff. And what is about float stuff? Well, if it can put things side by side, it will. If it's not space, it will drop it down below. So we can easily have on a wider screen multiple columns, and on a narrower screen we can have one column. Third thing we're going to do, and maybe it's not a third thing, all right? Maybe it's just sort of an addition to the first thing. So we're even going to do this with images. So instead of saying an image is a certain number of pixels wide, we're going to give the image a percentage. So it can take up a certain percentage of the space on the screen. So on a big screen, it takes up more space. On a narrow screen, it will take up less. So this stuff, we sort of know already. All right? We sort of know already. What don't we know? Applying different style sheets under different conditions. So approach one sort of encapsulates these two techniques. If we do this, we might develop a layout for our desktop and for our mobile device that looks the same. All right? We don't even have to mess with multiple style sheets. If we do, however, mess with multiple style sheets, we have to understand how to do that. All right? And we've already seen the potential of using multiple style sheets by taking our pages and applying different style sheets to them. Now we just need to know how to some of the time apply this style sheet, some of the time apply that style sheet. So that's what we're going to look at. I'm going to look at some of my old examples to see how well they stack up under this. And then I'm going to look at a brand new example that looks at applying a different style sheet under a different condition. So let me download the examples we had last time, and let me look at them. Now, remember again, you don't have a mobile device necessarily, but you can run an emulator. And built into the Chrome browser, there's an emulator that emulates mobile devices. And also there is an emulator called the Opera emulator, which is done by the browser called Opera. Which is another web browser that you can use to emulate different mobile devices. So that's really a challenge for web developers, right? Or any sort of developers. You know, you can't afford to buy a million different mobile devices to test your web page on all of them, right? So what you do, one of the things that you can do is you can run it up against an emulator. And that at least gives you a pretty good idea of how it's going to look. So let me go log on here. let me look at the different things that we did, and we'll try to figure out if these are good or bad for mobile optimization. And then we'll test our theory to see if we're right. Here's my prototypes from last time. First prototype, prototype one. Do we think this would look good on a mobile device or not? Or what would maybe not look good on it? What might look better? What could we do to make it look better?
Float.
We could float it. All right. The one thing I don't like about it is this obviously uses an absolute position or an absolute width for this. So as I make the browser window bigger or smaller, this area doesn't get any bigger or smaller. So how can I view this in a mobile device? I can go to More Tools, Developers Tools. I can pick this, and I can say on a... That doesn't look half bad. I guess this one doesn't look so bad. I think if we had a real low-end phone on this emulator, it would show as being bad. The one thing I do not like about this is that those are oriented horizontally. That might give us what you were talking about, just a small area to click on. All right. But what could improve this would be to use a percentage for that. Let's look up this. If we go to view this in a mobile device, this would be very hard to work with. If you can imagine this being a phone size thing. And on other phones, there would be some horizontal scrolling of this as well. Yes?
Is that the one where you pinned the pieces to an exact space?
I believe so. It's either that one or it's the relative position where I moved it up depending on where the flow position would put it. Can't remember which was which, two or three. Each of these were, one of them used absolute position, one of them used relative position, but essentially they did the same thing. And they're both going to be goofy this way, or it's going to be hard to read. Another thing you can do, by the way, besides using percentages, for fonts, use M's. So don't give a font that's 12 pixels wide. You use a font of so many M. Let's see, four. This is the one where we fixed the navigation on the side. Too good. I don't like the navigation like that. And I think the fifth one was the float. Which actually, I'm going to do what? I'm actually going to show this a different way by pretending we're on a real small phone and doing something like that. And notice how it went from two columns to one column. So this isn't perfect the way it is, but with a little bit of work, we could make this a more workable. So the more workable ones were the ones that we use either the flow or the float. All right. So now I'm going to show an example, and we should be able to start this example today, and we might need to polish it up on Thursday. But this is using different style sheets depending on whether you're on a mobile device or on a desktop device. Now this uses what are called media queries. Media queries is the brand new technical thing that we're going to talk about today. That's where we can specify under what conditions a certain style sheet is used. All right. And these have been used for a long time on websites. Even in the old days, even before mobile devices were real popular, you would have a print version of your page and a display version of your page. You know, if you're going to print an article from a magazine, you might not want the images, or you might not want the background colors. You might just want it to be a plain black print on a white background. So you could actually create a style sheet for the print version of your page. Well, you can do that same thing for a mobile version of your page. So, let's look at that. And that's the new version that I, new example rather, that I uploaded for today's class. Now keep in mind that I'm not alleging that this is a particularly well-designed page. All right? A lot of the examples I do just to demonstrate some things, just to make it very obvious what the difference is. All right? One thing we'll talk about next time are two different ways to develop a mobile website. One is called progressive enhancement, and one's called graceful degradation. We don't have time to talk about that today, but what I will do is I will view the pages in the progressive enhancement folder, because that's sort of the preferred method. So, if I view this page in a desktop browser, this is how it looks. Notice a few things about it. It has white, type. It has an image there. It has three columns. This is floating, so as I make it smaller, the columns are percentages. So if I make it smaller, everything falls in line in one column. And it's a little more involved because it has multiple columns, it has an image, and it has a background image. Let's view the same page using the emulator. Like magic. What's different? Well, let's open it up in two different browsers to see the difference. Side by side. Same HTML file. It's opened up this exact same web page, so there's no trickery going on here. What's the difference? Well, the color of the font is different. The font that I'm using is different. The desktop version has a serif font. The mobile version has a sans serif font. It looks like the border colors might be different. Actually, I think those are the same, the border colors. The navigation is oriented vertically in the desktop version. It's oriented horizontally in the mobile version. There's no background image. And instead of three columns, there's one column. And also, guess what? The picture's gone. We made the picture disappear. All right? Now, one thing to be clear about. This is just like the CSS Zen Garden or the assignments that you did in this class. These both use identical HTML. So it's not like I have a mobile version which I went and deleted the image. It's my CSS that controls whether that image appears or not. All right. Remember, we said anything dealing with the layout or the appearance of a web page. Well, making something invisible is an aspect of the appearance of the web page. So what I want to do to conclude today is look at the example HTML, and we'll see how I use a media query to give or to apply different CSS to both pages. So I go here and I edit this guy in Notepad. Forget these lines for a minute. All right? Actually, you can forget them until Thursday. Thursday we'll talk about these. What I'm interested in for today are these two lines. These are two different CSS files that are on the same web page. All right? The first one doesn't have a media query. It looks just like the CSS files we've been doing since we started learning about CSS files. What versions of the web page gets this CSS file? All of them. All right? So without a media query, all right, without a media query, this CSS file will apply to both the desktop and the mobile version. All right? This CSS file, however, is different. It applies only if you're talking about a screen, you know, which is a display screen, and the minimum device width is at least 601 pixels, and that's kind of a small number because most monitors are bigger than that. Effectively, what this does is this makes the second style sheet apply only when the page is being viewed in the desktop, on a desktop browser. Everyone gets this style sheet. This style sheet is only for the desktop. So what does that mean? It means that there's going to be some things here in this style sheet that this guy overrules. All right? But it doesn't overrule it all the time. It only overrules it in the case of it being a desktop browser. Because only with desktop browsers does this style sheet apply. And let's look at one example of that before we end for the day. I shouldn't look at the mobile, I should look at the base. That's the one I wanted. Because that's the one. That's one of the two style sheets, base and desktop. Notice the style that I have for the image. Section image display none. What does that do? Makes the image invisible. It doesn't display it. Notice what I do in the desktop version now. The desktop version displays it as an inline element. So it does display it in the desktop version. So, I have two CSS files. This one always applies. This one only applies in the case of a desktop browser. So this one hides the image. This one overrules the hiding of the image and makes it visible again. But, because it has a media query, it only does that if it's being viewed in a desktop browser. So, on a mobile browser, This one hides it. This one does nothing. The second style sheet does not take effect. All right? And therefore, the image remains hidden. In this version, though, the second style sheet does apply, and therefore, the second style sheet overrules the first, and therefore, we see the image. So that's kind of what we're going to be doing in these. We're going to set up two style sheets for this, one of which applies all the time, the other of which overrules that style sheet to make it look different in a desktop environment than a mobile environment. To look real quickly at one last thing, notice there's no background on the body on the mobile version or the all version. The desktop version gives it a background URL. So in the first case, everyone starts off as having no background. The second style sheet comes around, and only in the case of a desktop version of the page does the first style sheet get overruled and the second one apply and adds the background. We'll look at this in more detail next time. All right? Any questions now? All right. We'll see you in a minute.